This is Zige, the flying creature. Al Jarat, the ruthless one. Titi Dal, the calamity. The desert locust yet again bringing destruction to man's crops. We count the cost in millions of pounds, thousands of tons of food, in the livelihood of the farmer, ultimately in the lives of 300 million people. Our insurance lies in effective methods of destruction and in close knowledge of the locust itself. Its natural habitat is the vast stretch of scrubland and desert running across Africa, the Middle East, and Western Asia. It is an impressive creature. The adult male is as long as a man's finger and powerfully built. It has five eyes, two compound, and three simple. A broad field of vision, but a shallow one. Like all insects, the locust has six legs, the rearmost pair being particularly well developed, enabling it to jump and move at speed. Such a powerful insect has a large food consumption. It weighs roughly 2 grams, and its great jaws devour its own weight of vegetation each day. As an individual, harmless enough, but with just one medium-sized swarm of 1,000 million individuals, the daily rate of destruction is as much as 2,000 tons. These ravening swarms are comparatively slow flyers, but their endurance is remarkable. Carried along on the wind, they have been known to remain airborne over a distance of 1,200 miles. The distance between the breeding grounds of successive generations may be as much as 3,000 miles. It is in the breeding period that the difference between the sexes becomes most clearly pronounced. In the male, the reproductive organs in the rearmost segment of the abdomen are conical in shape, whereas in the female, the tip of the abdomen is formed by the two pairs of ovipositor valves, which look like hooks. Apart from this, the female is slightly larger and often less vividly colored than the male, here seen on her right. Climatic conditions determine the length of time the adult takes to reach maturity. This may be anything from 6 weeks to 6 months. Mating occurs when maturity is reached. During pairing, the male sits on the female, clasping her with the front and middle legs. The abdomen is twisted sideways and downwards, the female curving round to meet it. Fertilization is complete within 2 hours, but the couple may remain paired for much longer. Almost immediately after mating, the female searches for damp ground and begins to lay her eggs. She arches her abdomen downwards, and the ovipositor burrows into the ground. In this way, a hole is made, down which the abdomen extends. Bottom, the hole is widened to take the eggs. They are orange-yellow in color and can be seen through the body wall. Some 50 eggs are laid in a foamy secretion, which is a protection against excessive moisture or drought. A single female will usually lay 2 or 3 such egg pods in the course of her life, but a much higher number is not uncommon. After 14 days or so, incubation is complete. The young hatchlings break through the egg's outer skin and begin to climb. An air sac behind the head is inflated to grip the walls, and the body is contracted. Then the sac deflates and the head pushes upwards until the surface is reached. Arrived on the surface, the hatchlings shed their thin surrounding membrane and become recognizable as young locusts. This scene is being repeated millions of times over an area of many square miles, the extent of the egg bed. The skin rapidly darkens after emergence until it becomes almost black. Supplied with food by the ephemeral vegetation which has grown up with it, the young locust, or hopper, begins to grow. Development is in fact continuous, but is outwardly apparent as a series of six stages. During each stage, the outer skin remains the same size and the hopper grows inside it. When this process is complete, the skin splits over the head and the hopper wriggles free. This is the third shedding, and the rudiments of the wings can now be clearly seen. When almost completely free from the old skin, the hopper pauses before swinging onto the stem, there to rest until the new skin hardens. At the fourth stage, the young locust is well advanced towards maturity. As it has grown, so it has joined forces with others from the original egg bed, and it is now possible to see something of the way it behaves in a group. Early in the morning, the hoppers settle down to bask in the sun, aligning themselves to absorb the maximum radiation. As the temperature of the ground and surrounding air rises, they become more active, more responsive to the movements of others. Where groups of hoppers are sufficiently dense, this response generates a strong tension, resulting in an outbreak of movement in a fortuitous but definite direction. These marching bands of hoppers, now seen at the fifth stage, have traveled several miles from the hatching ground and are spread out over a wide front. Climb up into suitable vegetation to shed their skin for the last time. The locust now has its wings, but as yet they are soft and crumpled. Hanging from the branch, the fledgling adult pumps blood through them until they become fully extended. For a week or so, the young fledglings continue to bask in the trees, making short daily flights as if testing their wings. Testing their wings for the day when they depart en masse for the breeding grounds. Migration is on its way. A dense rolling cloud darkens the sky for mile after mile. Another wind carries destruction in its path. But the teeth of the wind can be drawn. As closely as conditions allow, its course is being watched and recorded. Here in the mapping room of the Anti-Locust Research Centre in London, reports are received from all over the area. Reports of breeding grounds, hopper bands, and flying swarms. They are first plotted, country by country, on a detailed map, and then transferred to a general map of the whole area. This work has been going on for over 25 years, gradually building up a picture of the locust movements. But the picture is never a final one, because the locust remains essentially an opportunist, its movements no more predictable than are the climatic conditions which give rise to them. Nevertheless, on the basis of maps such as these, it is possible to produce forecasts of probable developments. And from analyses carried out over the years, certain general conclusions can be drawn. We know that we have to deal with a vast area, covering some 50 countries. An eighth of the entire world population is subject to the threat of devastation by the desert locust. Somewhere within this infestation zone, wherever climatic conditions are favorable, locusts are breeding during every month of the year. Between January and June, it occurs within the northern part of the zone, with an extension southward around the Red Sea. Migrations then take place to summer monsoon areas, which are favorable to breeding between July and October. Centered round the southern Red Sea and the Somali Peninsula, a third area is suitable for breeding in November and December. However, by no means all the swarms of the summer generation find conditions for reaching sexual maturity in this period. They await the return of suitable conditions in the following spring. This is the overall pattern of movement, but it varies with the weather, as does the actual distribution of breeding. In the spring of 1954, for instance, breeding was widely scattered throughout the zone. In May, swarms breaking out from the area were sighted at these points. In June, they were more widely distributed. By July, they were reported concentrating in the summer breeding areas. And later reports indicated the full extent of the breeding grounds for that summer. The value of these reports cannot be overstressed. On them depends the monthly forecast of locust movements. This forecast is sent out to all the control organizations in the area, in time to warn them of approaching swarms. And time is the crucial factor in their fight against the locust. They already have the weapon, the insecticide, product of the chemical laboratory. But research continues, improving methods of application. In the wind tunnel, spraying techniques are tested under conditions simulating those encountered in the air. On On the laboratory bench, exhaustive tests reveal the most economical dosages for both stomach and contact poisons. The desert locust can be attacked in a number of ways, but our aim is always the same, to destroy it. Destroy it we must. Why should anyone go hungry? Because of the ruthless one.